What's going on, G-verse? Interesting Facebook conversation that was going on. There's this movie, I haven't seen it yet. It's by the name of Dead. I don't know if you can get it on Netflix, but essentially, it's a apocalyptic type deal. The world goes to hell, and they're having these tribunals where you stand up and you present your case for why you should live or die. And there was this one thing where this guy says, I'm a publish, bam! Even before he got poet out, he was shot. So essentially, I love the conversation because we may not be going to science fiction level damnation and doom, but economically, there are many people that are in very similar situations. They may not be shot with a gun or stabbed or set on fire. However, it's the same thing. You step up to the tribunal looking for a job, and they just put the gun to your head and say, no, no money, you're dead. And I started to think, what's really, you know, there's this guy, you should check him out. His name is Andrew McAfee. He's a professor at MIT. He and his partner, I cannot remember his name right now, but they do research on work. And they were on 60 Minutes, and you know, I've followed the guy for a while. We are heading to a situation where we're not going to need as many people to do things because of automation, outsourcing, and efficiencies that are being created by technology. We're just not. This YouTube channel, which I don't take for granted, there is a total, there's 838-40 videos that you can see, but there's a total of 1,050 videos on this channel. I calculated the cost going back, say, 10 years for me to do what I've done for sweat equity, my personal time, and roughly, say, $10,000. Let's go ahead and just to say, you know, with everything, you know, buying music, buying pictures for thumbnails, things like that. Maybe 15 grand going on 5 years. So you can almost say $2,000 to $3,000 a year cost for this channel or expenses. But if I were to replicate what I've done with this channel going back 10 years, it would have cost me $1.5 million to do what I did for roughly 15 grand. I want you to think about that. 10 years in the span of mankind is not a long time. You know, if you're a kid, 10 years is forever. If you're 60, 10 years goes by like that. But it is not a long time. And what's happening with society, the technology is snowballing at a faster rate to the point that industries are created, billionaires made, and the business model is over in 4 to 8 years. People come in, do it, make a lot of money, and it something else replaces it. That is where we are. So if you are going to the job tribunal, many people are finding out they're putting that economic gun to their head and going, bam. And it's increasing because I talk to more people than the average person doing my consulting business, the 30 days to $2,500 a month Facebook group and other things that I do. I talk to a lot of people. I hear a lot of stories. I am a member of probably 35 Facebook groups, maybe 40. And I'm very active in about 15 where I'm either observing or reading threads every day, or I'm participating or commenting. I'm very active in about 15. So day after day, I see things that the average person doesn't see, because if you have a job, 2.5 kids, and you go to work, come home, and you then get wasted on the weekends because, you know, during those 1.5 days that you're free, you don't know this stuff and you're living in a bubble. And I'm seeing more and more people economically displaced are shot during the economic apocalypse, because it's weird, because things are not as bad as they were 2006 to 2012, but it's compartmentalized, because for some people their situation is worse now than it was back then, and it's accelerated. So we don't have a major economy. We have sectors and segments of economy. Some of them are booming. The people that are in these segments are making outrageous money. I shouldn't say outrageous. They're making incredibly good money for the efforts that they put out. And there are other people in sectors that used to do well who are damn near bankrupt, are about to lose the home, and they don't wonder. And they, because the thing is, you got to understand, hard work in the wrong area is a waste of time. Hard work in the area that used to be great but no longer serves you is still a waste of time. Many people cannot believe that the party's over, the Kool-Aid is stale, and certain days are not coming back ever, ever again. Well, my query for you today is for, let's just call it the zombie financial economic apocalypse. Everything as you know it is gone. You're heading up to the tribunal and they're asking you, sir, ma'am, why should you live? What skills do you have to contribute to the world at large today? And ask yourself, if we got to that point, would you be one of the people still living, or would you be one of the people shot in the head? Because the thing is, during this, you know, and I haven't seen it, but I'm understanding why they're doing what they're doing. It seems incredibly cruel. But if you're in that world, resources are limited. You can't waste resources on people who are not contributing. Now, there's a parallel that's going on with that last statement, if you really think about it. And every time I say something like this, someone's like, you're the Republican. And I'm not a Republican. I am not a Democrat. My personal political views are this: both parties are fucking all of us. When you really lift up the skirt and look under there, you see the varicose veins on the political legs of these people. You understand that a lot of them are friends, they're in cahoots, and when they retire, they still work together. I don't think all of this, the Republicans, the Democrats, is bullshit. And if you're wedded to that, more wedded, because I had a friend who was really caught up in that. He was really caught up in it. And when he, you know, I told him, I said, you really need to let the political posturing go. Stop worrying about Obama. Stop worrying about this stuff. And focus with a laser-like intensity on your business. You're going to be in better shape. About 8 months goes by, you know, after I tell him this. And I see on his page that he's had the most profitable month ever during one of his traditionally slow months. That is what a laser-like focus on your business will do for you. Understand, you know, this thing with the economy, there's a personal economy and there's the greater economy at large. If you're handling your personal economy, you know, going back with the apocalyptic scenario, say you are the chief of the village. There's about 500 people in the village. These 500 people have to make the clothes, make the food. And you're the chief because you have certain skills. You know how to make bullets. You know how to dig in the ground, pick up that ore, roast those bullets over fire, and create power, a way to kill animals and a way to create implements of protection for the village. You're a very powerful dude because you're a producer. 500 people, the world's gone to shit, but because you can produce something that is needed, you have become rich in a barren world. That same opportunity for the chief in the village exists for you today. There's someone posted in two groups, actually four groups, and actually in one of my personal group pages about this company that did a Kickstarter project like 2 years ago. It's for virtual reality. They were asking for $250,000, and they got $2.5 million, and then Facebook bought them for $2 billion like recently. What did I say earlier in this video? Things are being created. People are becoming billionaires in between 2 and 6 years. Knowing what I know about how companies are built, this is not a big company. They don't have hundreds of employees. It's a handful of people. the top guys of that company, if they didn't become billionaires, they became close. Or they all received hundreds of millions of dollars. Just for those of you who are like, when the lottery's like 30 million, and because we're used to these mega payouts, it's like, yeah, you know, 30 million is not a lot. Which is silly, because 30 million is an incredibly large sum of money. These guys, 300 million, let's just say they get 300 million each, pay their taxes, they're still at 200 million. That kind of money just watched, not even really super invested, just watched over and marginally invested. No crazy stuff, just because the thing is, at that point, it's about the preservation of capital, preservation of wealth. You're not trying to make money because you already have money. You're trying not to lose money and let your wealth be eradicated by inflation and other factors. There, 10 generations down the road, their family can be still living off that money. And the principal has grown, and the interest it cast off has grown even more. That is the power of a financial education. So these guys are set for life. They're probably, you know, I haven't done any research in the company. They're probably not even 30 years old. And that is the power of the new economy. So ask yourself, what can you bring to the table to keep your ass from being shot? It's really interesting because I'm an online guy now. 5 years, I've made all my income online. I've dipped and dabbed, and I've kind of played around because, you know, it was hard to... Let me go back. I made most of my money online because I was kind of dipping and dabbing with reselling. I was still selling on Craigslist pretty hard because it's fun. Flipping shit is fun. But about 2 years ago, I stopped and just focused on making money online through digital products, videos, webinars. It's a really interesting journey because the more you produce, the more money you can make. Doesn't mean, you know, I produce a lot of stuff that doesn't work. I put up webinars that fall flat. I put up videos, people like, we're not trying to do that one, Glendon. We don't really need that. Then I come up with something I don't think is going to really do that well, and it blows my mind. What I'm telling you is, in your way of developing yourself, start doing more. Start putting more stuff out in the world, because I didn't know I could do this stuff. Didn't know I could write books. Didn't know that I could do video. I didn't know. I mean, it was just all an experimentation and exploration in the world. Start doing stuff. If you got like a little notion, or you have this ideal in your head that you want to do something a little different, you want to perhaps start a cookie company or perhaps start a daycare, do it. Try it. See what you learn. Even if you fail, you win. And I'm going to give you some parameters on this. One of the biggest reasons, and I'm a business consultant, I talk to a lot of people, one of the biggest barriers to people starting a business is fear. Not money, not lack of education, none of that stuff. It is fear. Then the second barrier is too many financial obligations to free your time, which is your most important resource, to do something different. I live simple for a reason, because it gives me the time to do something. Like if I want to, I'll tell you, 2012, I switched up my business model. I hired an assistant that came on site every day, was doing a lot of social media. I mean, for 6 months straight, that was probably my worst year doing this, because the money that I put out, and the last part of the year, I was living on savings, because I had spent so much money. I invested in some areas that I didn't. I made a lot of mistakes in 2012. But this is the rub. The money that I made the first 4 months of 2012 was enough for me to live on, because I did not have a lot of expenses. I mean, I don't have a high burn rate, and I purposely keep it. I don't have cable. I do not have cable TV. I don't have a lot of subscriptions to stuff. There's a lot of things that I sit back and ask, okay, is this worth spending the money on? Because are you going to use it? This vehicle I'm in, it took me freaking 2 years to make the decision to buy it. And then once I made the decision, it took me like about 6 months to actually find one that that fit my parameters. When you encumber yourself with stuff, when you encumber yourself, it makes it very hard for you to do those things you want to do in terms of starting a business. And you know, if you're like a kid, and a kid is 16 to 25 in my opinion, and you have no debt, you have no credit card profile or credit record, you're in a prime position to start a business because you have no baggage. You have no anchors on you. You have nothing. You are clean. You are so clean. You walk in the room, it lights up because your ass shines. But because you are set up in the indoctrination of, for me to be an adult, I got to get a house. I got to get a car. I got to go to college. You got to do all of this stuff, spend all of this money to be what other people said that you needed to be, with little regard to who do you want to be based on your personal edification. Many people get caught up, and that's the reason that there's so many videos here on YouTube about people with high student loan debt, with high debt lows, period, and they just feel trapped like a rat. I guess that's why it's called a rat race. But you're clean. If you're clean, don't worry about, you have, don't. I mean, this is just from me to you. If you're a kid and you have no clue to what the hell you want to do, do not go to college until you truly figure it out. Join the military, go to vocational school, something that you can get in 3 months, 6 months, maybe a year, get in, get out, go to work, start earning money, and not load yourself up with a bunch of debt. And I'm going to say something that's going to sound strange coming from me. All debt is not bad. There are many people that think if it's debt, it's bad. No. There's certain debt that will make you rich. But consumer debt, just debt for going on vacations, doing stupid shit like using your excess student loan money to potentially take a trip or buy furniture around your house, you're fucking stupid if you're doing that. Because that interest rate is outrageous. And they've upped the interest rate, and they've cut off cheaper student loan programs, and they've changed a lot of things. And you can't bankrupt out of that. That shit can hunt you until you're 60-something. So don't even get caught up in it. Work on doing something that way you can go into a city or a town and say, hey, my name is Mr. Clean, or my name is Miss Clean, and these are the services, products, or whatever that I can offer to you. Start thinking that way. What can you do to serve your community? Not what you can do to get money. That's a different thought process. That's a whole different level of hustling and entrepreneurship that can be limited. When you start thinking about how can I serve a lot of people, your money will grow exponentially. That's like, you know, I'll even get, well, personal. I had one of my friends, you know, he is a pan-Africanist. You know, black people this, black people this. And I'm just like, I have never set up a company. I've written one book that was kind of aimed at a segment, and I actually regret doing it. But 99% of what I do is targeted for the public at large. Because the public at large is bigger than segments. Now, some segments can serve you well. Like, what is it, a Birkin bag, a $35,000, $40,000 for a bag. They only serve a small segment, but that segment is fantastically wealthy. And they may pick up 3 bags, and it doesn't cost $35,000 to make that bag. It doesn't. It's the name, it's the cachet, it's all of that. It's a different crowd, but essentially, when you are building a company, think broad. Think how many people you can serve with your product. Think very broad. And what you can do later on, after you've got it up and running, then you can turn a laser on to a certain segment. Because why I say think broad is you don't know what your company's going to do until you start it. That's why I say business plans are like great works of fiction, like Moby Dick. You know, That's what they are, the great works of fiction, until you validate them and put them into play. Go broad, then laser it out, because I've seen people spend years trying to hit a target or a segment, spend all kind of money, and then they start the business, and it doesn't work because they never started the business. If they started the business first before all the planning, they would have had much richer data to operate on and make better decisions. This is one of the reasons that so many people fail. They start too big with too much money. That's why I said, if you're a kid, you're clean. You're clean. This is the time to fail. This is the time, if you want to get a backpack and go to Europe for 6 months, do it. This is the time. You can probably do it at 38 or 40 after your kid, but it's going to be different. I traveled Japan, Korea, other places when I was really young. It's a totally different feel, because you're so full of this vitality and this energy, and everything is brand new, it's shiny, and all the experiences. You are not going to be like that when you're older and a little jaded. It's not going to be the same. It can still be very enriching. It can still be fun. But I'm telling you, my trip to a certain South American country, and I will not say which one because I was very young, was incredibly life-altering. It really was. It just totally changed my perspective on so many things. And it came at a point where I was still developing personal philosophies, where I was still growing as a man. This is the time to do it. So don't get caught up in all that. Well, I need to go to college. I need to be out by 22. And no. Live your life. Live your life. So going back to Mr. Pan-Africanist, he was on my ass. And he was just like, you need to do... He told me straight up. He said, with your business knowledge, you need to do a business education course for black men. You need to put together a book, and you need to do this and reach out into the community. Now, what he did not know was I got my early business education from some white dudes in my neighborhood, Adamsville, Alabama. One of them was Mr. Youngblood. Everyone talks stuff. I didn't know this guy was an industrialist. He was just, to me, was a nice, his wife was super nice to me. They let me hang around the shop. They would talk to me. I didn't realize that I was soaking up business knowledge as a kid. I didn't realize that. I was just hanging out with some cool people that gave me cookies and, gave me spending money when I would do just a few simple tasks. The shit was awesome. The next one was over at Simmons Machinery. I was walking around and I just thought it was cool because, those huge earth movers? I mean, the ones that are tall as your house. He had several of them. I didn't know. He was a developer. I looked it up years ago, and they've got this landfill now. But the guy was a developer. And he had not one, but two helicopters. Now, I never met the guy, but I would walk by. And, I'm a kid. I'm a boy. And he had dump trucks and stuff. And I walk up there, touch him, and look at the wheel and everything. If it was like now, I would be taking pictures and selfies and shit. But one day I was walking by there, and the guy was the helicopters, and I was just sitting there, and I was asking all these kind of questions, and he was just telling me about the turbines, and he was just telling me that aircraft parts have certain lifetime usage. You can only fly this for so many hours where you have to discard it because it develops internal cracks and everything. And then one day, out the blue, he's like, you want to take a ride? Dude took me up in a helicopter. I got to see my city from really high up, and it wasn't that big. And that's probably one of the reasons I left. I think it was around 13 at the time. Those were my experiences. So I never developed what some people will classify as a loyalty to a certain, I get into a lot of trouble because I don't do that to myself because I know better. And we get into it, and he's a good dude, but the deal is if you're doing black hair care, yeah, that's a huge fucking market. It's been put out that the average black woman's going to spend 100 G's in their lifetime caring for her hair. $100,000 lifetime for the head. I don't know how much women spend. I didn't look up that stat, but I did it. Now, I was like, this is why everyone's getting your hair care. But essentially, I refuted that idea because everyone's been coming after me lately about doing stuff like that. And you need to do this, you need to do this, you need to do this. And then whenever I hit them back with, why don't you do it? Then I'm hit with cricket, cricket, cricket. This is another thing that I'm at, and this is, goes really in part with developing skills. Don't ever tell someone else what they should do with their time and talents unless they ask you. If you see a need, and this is what I told my friend, and I haven't heard from him in 2 weeks because I pissed him off. I said, what the fuck you need to do is develop some business skills, start a business, and then you go out there and do it since it's so fucking important to you, because it's not important to me. And, you know, he's just like, man, you know, you're one of those, you're a Republican, you're not appreciating the experience. I was like, dude, I grew up poor. I was in a fucking boarding house. You know, went through a divorce, ended up fucking homeless. Who the fuck are you talking to? And it hit me why people are like that. Everyone wants to be management. Everyone wants to be management. But no one wants to be the worker bee. I was the worker bee for a long time. In the military, I was enlisted. Worked all those shit jobs in the labor pool, did all of that crazy stuff. So I know what it's like to be a worker bee, and I know what it's like to have a good manager or good leader. And I know what it's like to have a suck-ass manager and a suck-ass leader. So it helped me become a better person, a better businessman. And people do not want to go through that grooming process. They don't want to go through it. They don't want, that's what I'm saying. Get out, start doing some stuff, start making some stuff, start working on the business and taking your ideals into the marketplace. Really, really start doing that. Start, just get started. Like my course, 30 days to $2,500. Is a business development course for any business. It's not like how to be resale. It's to take you through the processes, and each day you have to do something. That is the secret ingredient. Action is the greatest truth there is. There's nothing that compares to it. Action is the greatest truth. So you have to really, 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 really be active and put stuff into your life and do things and really become a person of productivity and a producer. There's a story of this girl. I don't know her name, but the name of the company is Owl, and that's OWL Origami. Look it up. The girl's like 18 freaking years old. She started this company when she was 14. Last year, they did $250 million in sales. 1, 2, 3, 4 years. And it's a jewelry company. So she didn't bring, you know, it's a jewelry company. Just look up the story, you know, just, or, you know, Google it. And it's a wonderful, wonderful story. It's really, really cool. And it just shows you the power of productivity. Not sitting on your ass, not whining about the economy, not whining about Obama, not whining about the affordable health care, not whining about your miserable fucking life, because everyone goes through some shit. I have gone through a lot of shit. Recently had some developments in my life. And when I was having one of those bad days, as we all do, I got in my vehicle and I went to the hospital and I parked in the parking lot and I just looked at the hospital and realized there was someone in there dying. There was someone that was just told that day they had cancer. There were so many people that their lives are so fucked up that my problems just went. And that's what they were. Because everyone struggles, but some people will take a struggle, and I'm classifying it, that's the size of a dime and make it the size of the moon. And then other people who have the moon of a struggle, and because of their positive attitude and the way they look at life, they crank it down where it's the size of a dime, and they go on and be happy with all of this miserable stuff going on. I try to be that kind of person. You know, stuff happens, things go bad, but becoming despondent, just getting really down, just make stuff worse. And you hear all this advice. It's like, you know, it's going to happen. You know, if you need to fall apart, just fall apart. It has been my experience that working through pain, because I had to work through a lot, and I have a different process than most people. You know, everyone's got their own process, but working through it, and working through it is not saying, oh, there's no pain. You know, there's not, it's not saying, oh, I'm not hurt. It's saying I'm hurt. But, you know, for me, being active helps with that. Just sitting home, I'd probably be depressed and popping all kind of drugs if I did that. I'm actually outside my old warehouse because I got to talk to a friend. And I remember because I'm sitting in front of my old doctor when some shit went down. I had heartbreak and I developed a new business plan versus going home. I don't drink a lot. I don't smoke anything. I've never been drunk or high. And I just worked through the pain because I was fucking hurting. I mean, God, man, it was just like, damn. And the action, you know, it's just keep the blood going, keep, you know, I thought about it, you know, and I had the music blasting, I was doing all this stuff. That helped me more than just sitting at home. You know, sitting at home makes you feel good, fine, you know, but be active, you know, work through your pain. I think a lot of artists produce some of their best work when they're going through something because their soul is ripped open and all of that essence and genius and stuff just comes out because it's not locked down because they're so blown that they can't put on those personal safeguards that we all have to make ourselves look, you know, better than we are when we're really falling apart. So all that shit's blown and it just comes out, and it comes out on the page, it comes out in the music, it comes out in management. You get incredible stuff. So you can like use your pain, drama, angst, whatever, to make yourself better, or you can make yourself worse by becoming addicted to drugs or something. So there's a lot of things that you can do to not get shot in the head. There's a lot you can do to not get shot in the head, because Conundrum Publishing, which is now Conundrum Media, was started in 2009. And what do we know was happening in 2009? It was the Great Recession, or as I classified, the Great Depression number two. That was going on, and I've started a business, and it was one of the best ideas I've ever done in my life. Writing that first book, it was one of the best decisions of my life. It cost me some family shit, and I look back, and I'm glad I did it, because you can't change it. When you do something like that, it's done, it's history, it's proof to the world that you will take a chance. It's etched, it's forever etched in the world of, hey, Glendon did this, it happened. It's proof, it's validation. And I will tell you, when that, I got the galley, because, you know, at the time, Create Space would make, would send you a printed copy, and it had this little green cover and all this jacked up font. And I sat in my little chair and I spun around and went, wee, I wrote a book. It was a moment. And that, to me, you know, a lot of people are looking like, how do you develop self-esteem? I'll tell you, real simple, do some shit and accomplish it. Start small, work your way up, and keep increasing your goals. Because when I do a new project, even though it may fail, I'm not destroyed, because for all of my losses, I've had a lot of winners. And you're not going to get the winners if you don't have the losses. It's not going to happen. I mean, it's just not. And that's what people's like, I'm not trying to lose any money. I'm not trying to look bad. I'm not trying to be embarrassed. I'm not trying to fail. You're not trying to succeed either. Because when you're not trying to do something, you're putting the safeguards on. You're putting the locks on. And you're not going to go too far. So if you don't want to be shot in the head in the zombie economic apocalypse, what can you do? What kind of talent can you bring to the world that people want? What can you do? Really think about that. What can you do? So just something for you to think about, something for you to digest, and something for you to look upon with a certain amount of expectation, positive expectation. I mean, for real. All right. This is Glendon. I'll see you on the good side. And be sure to get my book, The Hustler's Mindset. No, I want you to get this book, because I'll get both of them. The Hustler's Mindset, Pimp Your Mind for Success, is free. Also get Hustlenomics, The Art of Making Money in the New Economy, which is what this video is kind of talking about, because that's a beta project. You know, once you hit the link, you'll see what I'm talking about. But go ahead and get both, because that book has changed the lives of a few people, and I'm very proud of that. And there's more stuff that's coming. And with that, all right, this is Glendon, and I'll see you on the good side.